The conclusion of the theorem is the existence of a rational section of this vibration. It is a theorem about the existence of rational sections of vibrations. So maybe we're not particularly interested in vibrations into hypersurfaces, but into other kinds of varieties. And when the base... Sorry. Is it okay? And when the base is a curve, it is known what we should expect, what is the correct good generalization of this theorem. And this is the so-called Graber-Arisen-Star theorem. That says, now I restrict to the case where the base is a curve.
Then, every rationally connected variety X over the function field of the curve has a rational point. So let me label the it was little 1 and little 2. And okay, maybe. And this has the same geometric interpretation. If I have a vibration over a curve with rationally connected fibers, then there is a rational section. Okay. So I will want to look at the analogous questions over the field of real numbers. And if I just replace C by R everywhere, I get statements that are false. So this fails in general. So a very easy counterexample is the stupid case where the base has dimension 0 and is just a point over R, and I take for x a quadric with no real points. In projective space. So this looks like a very stupid example, but you can make this example more general. More generally, when you have a vibration x over b, and you have a real point in the base, but the fiber over this real point has no real points. Sorry? Absolutely. And it is a situation, the total space might have real points, but not above all the real points of the base. And it is a, so, yeah. So it is a more general situation where you see you cannot expect rational sections. And, okay. And so you need to modify the statements to expect theorems. And the most brutal way to modify the statement has been proposed by Long. And in a conjecture in 53, so just after proving the Zeng-Long theorem, Long's conjecture is that this should remain true over the field of real numbers if you assume that the base has no real points. So I take B over R of dimension I, and I assume that the base has no real points, and then the conclusion holds. So then every degree D hypersurface of small enough degree has a rational point. So it is the idea of Long that real varieties with no real points should behave like complex varieties. And of course, now you know how to transform this theorem into a real conjecture.
Is the existence of any point operational invariant?
Yes, of smooth projective varieties. So, okay, so for the base, it's not a problem because I'm only the statement is about the function field of the base anyway. And yes.
But I mean, if you have some real points, you can just throw them away. You will get a variety B with no real points.
No. If there is a smooth real point on B, then the real points are Zariski dense by the implicit function theorem. So, yes. So I could generalize it to B has no smooth real points, but this is if yes. So the conjecture that corresponds to this statement, I think it is fair to attribute it to Manin and Collard. Maybe they have not written the precise statement, but they're the one that understood that rationally, the role played by rationally connected varieties in this matter. And so I take B over R a curve with no real points. Then every rationally connected variety X over the function field of B has a rational point. Okay, and so again, it may be a good thing to think about this statement geometrically. My variety over the function field of B, I view it as a fibration, and I can look at the fibration at the level of complex points, and then the question is the existence of a rational section of this fibration that is defined over R, that is equivariant for the action of the complex conjugation. Yes, so these statements are really equivariant statements of this equivalent variants of these theorems with respect to the action of complex conjugation. Okay, and an example of a particular case of this conjecture that is of particular interest is for the base B, you are going to take the real conic with no real points. So the simplest real curve with no real points. And for X, you are going to take X, a rationally connected variety that is already defined over R. In other words, the fibration that I'm looking at is the constant fibration with fiber X. And then the conclusion of the conjecture is the existence, the conjecture claims the existence of a morphism from B to X. The section of the fibration is really given by a morphism from B to X. That is from a rational curve in X, because this is a conic, it's a curve of genus zero. And so if my real rationally connected variety has no real point, this is an open question of Collard. And it's interesting, the hypothesis that X is rationally connected is the existence of many rational curves over the complex numbers. And the question here is to find one that is defined over the real numbers. So what is known about these conjectures? So for the first conjecture that concerns hypersurfaces, what is known is the case where the hypersurface has odd degree. And so this has been proven by Lang. This is what he knew when he asked the conjecture. And the proof is the same as the Tsen-Lang theorem. So I should have insisted that the Zemlang theorem is an elementary theorem. The proof is maybe 15 lines long. It's elementary manipulation of polynomials. And here you can do the same. The only thing you have to use is that real polynomials of hot degree have real roots. This is the only additional argument. Real roots of hot degree polynomials. Okay. And the second kind of thing that is known about this conjecture, so let me say for the second conjecture, here I'm looking at rationally connected varieties, and it is the case where the rationally connected variety is a compactification of a homogeneous space. So say compactifications, smooth compactifications of homogeneous spaces under linear groups. And this is due to Steinberg in 65. And Steinberg's result is more general. It's not about varieties or homogeneous spaces over this field. It's about such varieties over any field of cohomological dimension 1. Steinberg's result is really not about real algebraic geometry, it's more about algebraic group theory. Okay. So now I will state the statements I want to explain today.
Sorry,
yes?
Are you saying that this, for example, rational functions over R has homological dimension 1?
I should have rational functions of function fields of real curves with no real points. They have cohomological dimension 1. And it's another instance of this idea that real varieties with no real points should behave like complex varieties. And in the same, if the real variety with no real points has dimension I, then its function field has cohomological dimension I. And whenever there is a smooth real point, it will have infinite cohomological dimension. So the first result is the following. So it's about over a surface. So I take S over R, a surface with no real points. Then every quadratic form in at least 5 variables over the function field of S has a non-trivial zero. And if you look, this is exactly the particular case of this conjecture, where the base is a surface, and where the fibers are quadrics. Because a quadratic form in at least 5 variables is the same as a quadric in a projective space that has dimension at least 4. And having a non-trivial zero is the same as having a rational point for the quadric.
Excuse me, do you expect that this conjecture of Lenk or more general conjecture of Manningham holds for any base of
It's a very good question. The answer is no, and it will be written in the board in 3 minutes. The answer is no. Okay, so this is the first statement. It's okay, a particular case of the conjecture of Lang. And the second statement is a particular case of this conjecture. It is a very it's the first particular case that was open. It is the case where the rationally connected variety is a degree 4 Del Pezzo surface. So I'm going to write it. Now my base is a curve with no real points. then every degree 4 del pezzo x over the function field of this curve has a rational point. Okay, and and what I want to say is that the theorem A implies this theorem immediately, and using a theorem due to Hammer and Brummer. Because if you have a degree 4 del pezzo surface over a field, so it's defined by a linear system of quadrics, let K be the field, then I view this linear system as a quadric over K parenthesis T. And it's what Hammer and Brummer say is that my del pezzo surface has a rational point if and only if this quadric over this bigger field has a rational point. So this reduces immediately this theorem to this theorem, and this implication has nothing to do with real geometry. It's very general over an arbitrary field. So I will concentrate on theorem A from now on. Okay, now I need to address your question. These two theorems so fail if I replace these function fields by function fields of cohomological dimension 2 here and 1 here. So, and this is respectively due to Merkuriev. For quadrics and to Colliot-Ellen and Mador for degree 4 del pezzos, who have shown that the statements fail over general fields of cohomological dimension. So 2 for the first statement and 1 for the second statement. So this, okay. So this shows that the theorems here do not fit into this kind of. It shows that these theorems really are theorems of real algebraic geometry. It's not just about the cohomological dimension of the field. You have to do some geometry to prove it. And obviously, they do not fit into this setting also because, I mean, there are not odd degree equations here. It's really quadrics and intersection of two quadrics. Okay. So, in the remainder of the talk, I will focus on theorem A. And the proof of theorem A will result from a study of the so-called period index problem. And as before, I will start by recalling what is known over the complex numbers. And the kind of question I will consider are generalization of a theorem of De Jong. That is the following. You take a complex surface and a class in the Brouwer group of its function field. Then, De Jong's theorem is that you can compute the index of this class, and it's easy, it's equal to its period. So let me quickly recall what index and period are. The period is the easiest, it's the order of alpha in distortion group. In the Brouwer group. And the index, it is say the smallest, but I could write the GCD if I wanted, the smallest degree of finite extensions of my field that kill the class, that split the class. And I will want to look at the real analogs of this statement. And over the field of real numbers, this statement fails in general. The naive analog fails and it has been known for a very long time. The first example is due to Albert. It's an example in the Brauer group of R parenthesis XY, that is the easiest function field of a real surface. And the class he considered is the tensor product of two quaternion algebra. So this is the usual quaternion algebra, the Hamilton one, and this is a fancy quaternion algebra. And both of them, as quaternion algebra, have order 2 in the Brauer group. So when I sum them, I get a class of order 2, that is a class of period 2. And Albert shows that this class has index 4. So you cannot expect a naive generalization of this theorem. But of course, you know now how to repair the statement. For instance, you can ask that the real surface S has no real points. And this, so this. But I will state a theorem B that is a little bit more general and that is also interesting for surfaces that have real points. So, as follows, I take a surface over R and I take alpha, a class in the Brauer group of its function field. And I need to make an hypothesis. What I do is I assume that when I restrict alpha to a real point of S, I get zero. So for all real points of S, whenever this is well defined. So what happens is that the Brauer class in the class in the Brauer group of the function field expands as a Brauer class of some open subset of S, and then whenever X is a real point of this open subset, I can evaluate, and my assumption is that I always get zero in this way.
So you exclude ramification.
Yes, but I mean, yes, because this would not make sense. But it suffices to check it for X, for all real points of a very, very small open subset of S. The point being that this quantity only, if you fix an open subset where alpha is well defined, this quantity only depends on the connected component of the real locus of this open subset. It's purely topological, so it varies continuously if you vary the real point continuously. So there is no ambiguity. Okay, and then the consequence is that it is very easy to compute the index of alpha while it is equal to the period. Okay. So what I will do, so this is the theorem I actually prove. I want just to explain quickly why it implies theorem A. And so this has been known also for a long time. It is entirely due to Hellman, Lamm, and Pfister. Oh, and I should have said, so this should hold with this precise condition of, I should have written two things. So first, I want to make clear, this condition obviously holds if the surface has no real points. For instance, if the surface has no real points, this applies. And the second thing I wanted to say is that this statement was conjectured by Pfister, more or less. I mean, the role of this vanishing condition in restriction to real points. Okay. So how do I prove theorem A? So I take S over R, a surface with no real points. So I let K be its function field. The point is that quadratic forms over K are very well understood. They're classified by their rank, by their discriminant, that are invertible functions modulo squares, and by their Clifford invariant. That is an element in the Brauer group of the field that has two torsions, that has period two. And so the reason for this classification, you can think of the rank as being an invariant in H0 of K, the discriminant as being an invariant in H1 of K, the Clifford invariant as being an invariant in H2 of K, but then this is a field of cohomological dimension 2. So there are no H3, H4, H5, etc. And this gives complete classification. Okay, now I take a quadratic form of rank 5 and I want to show it has a non-trivial zero. So I denote its discriminant by D, and it's Clifford invariant. So it is a two-torsion element in the Brauer group of K, so it has period 2. Now, I can apply theorem B. Theorem B tells you that it has index 2, that is, it is killed in a degree 2 extension of K, but the Brauer classes that are killed in a quadratic extension, they're exactly the quaternion algebra. So I can write it as a quaternion algebra. And so here I have applied theorem B.
Normal automatically.
Because it is
quadratic.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
And so when it's normal, you know that your class in the Brauer group is represented by division algebra of small dimension.
No, it has nothing to do with being normal or not. In fact, I could have defined the index. So alpha is represented by a division algebra. The dimension of the division algebra is the square of something, and this something is the index. So this index invariant, if you prefer, it's the size of the division algebra. Okay, and now I can conclude. So my quadratic form, I claim that it is isomorphic to 1 minus alpha minus beta alpha beta d as a quadratic form. And why is that so? Because I just compute invariants on both sides and they coincide. They have the same invariants. Same rank, same discriminant, same Clifford invariant. So by classification they coincide. Now I'm decide to view this five-dimensional quadratic form as a subform of this bigger one. And the point of this choice being that this form is a so-called Pfister form. And it has very nice properties, and that this choice is interesting comes from this isomorphism. And again, how do I check that these two quadratic forms are isomorphic? Well, I just have to verify that they have the same invariants. And now I'm almost done. Now this quadratic form, it contains a very big totally isotropic subspace of dimension 4. And just for dimension reasons, this four-dimensional totally isotropic subspace has to intersect the five-dimensional subspace that is my quadratic form. And so they intersect in at least one-dimensional subspace that is the non-trivial zero of the quadratic form I wanted to construct. So this proves theorem A. So just two comments. The first is that, okay, it looks like quadratic forms over this field were completely trivial because they're completely classified, but still one of the invariants is an element of the Brauer group, and Brauer groups, when you need to control them, and this is the role of theorem B. This is why we need theorem B to prove the theorem. And the second comment I want to make is that we only needed theorem B for two torsion Brauer classes. And in fact, this is the main case of theorem B, the case of two of Brauer classes of period 2.
So except for theorem B, this one that you used theorem A from theorem B, you also used one information about cohomological dimension, right?
I think so. So this was maybe not available to Hellman Lamfister. But thanks to Voyevodsky's work on the Milner conjecture, yes. And Hellman Lamfister knew this classification result, I think, using the precise shape of the field. But to answer your question, yes, I think so. Okay, now in the remainder of the talk, I'm going to explain the principle of the proof of theorem B. And I will. So the problem is that De Jong's strategy of proof fails over the real numbers. And so I will use another approach. Relying on Hodge theory. So, and I will first explain this different approach in a very particular case that is actually a particular case of De Jong's theorem, just to explain the strategy. And then I will explain what I need to modify in the proof to get theorem B. So first, to begin, I just explain the following theorem. So I mean, let's put De Jong again. It's a particular case of De Jong's theorem. So I take S over C, a smooth projective surface. And I take a class in the Brauer group of the function field of S that is unramified, that is, that belongs to the Brauer group of the whole surface, so that extends as the Brauer class on the whole surface. And then the conclusion you know, then the index of alpha may be computed as the period. Okay. So just to fix notation, I will denote by n the period of alpha. So alpha belongs to the n torsion of the Brauer group of the surface. And what do we need to do? We want to show that it has index n. So we want to show that it is killed on a degree n extension of C parenthesis S. But degree n extension of C parenthesis S corresponds to a surface, complex surfaces over S that have generically degree n over S. So we look for, our goal is to construct a morphism of smooth projective surfaces that is generically finite of degree n, and such that alpha vanishes on t. This is what we have to do. So of course, you cannot do it if you do not know what the Brauer group is. So you first need to describe what is the Brauer group of the surface. So first way to do it is to use the Kummer exact sequence. In etal topology and taking cohomology, you are going to get so H1 of GM is the Picard group, then you get H2 of mu n, and H2 of GM is by definition the Brauer group. So you get this description of the Brauer group, of the n torsion of the Brauer group of the surface, the quotient of H2 mu n by algebraic classes. But this is not the description we want to use. We will combine it with another short exact sequence that is obtained by taking Betti cohomology of the following exact sequence of sheaves for the Euclidean topology. So if you take cohomology, you're going to get so H2 of S Z mod n. Now it's for transcendental topology.
Isn't
this
a long sequence?
Yes, it's long sequences. But for instance, here I have peak of S goes to peak of S goes to H2 mu n. But so the subgroup of H2 mu n is the Picard group of S modulo the multiples of n. So, and in the same way, after H2 mu n, I have H Brauer group multiplication by n Brauer group. So the image is the n torsion of the Brauer group. So I have just extracted from the long exact sequence a short exact sequence, just because 1 over 3 arrow is just multiplication by n. And here it's exactly the same game. The subgroup I get of H2 of SZ mod n is H2 of SZ modulo what comes before, that are the multiples of n. And on the it's just what you get from the long exact sequences of cohomology. So this is modulo the multiples of n, and this is the n torsion part.
This is also given by the universal coefficients.
This? Yes, very likely, yes. Yes, absolutely. And now I notice that by comparison theorem between etal and Betti cohomology, the groups in the middle are the same. And once you've noticed that, you will manage to combine the two short exact sequences. You just combine them, and you're going to get the following short exact sequence, which is the one I want to use. So the subgroup is going to be H2 of SZ modulo the multiples of n and modulo the algebraic classes. Then in the middle, there is the group we want to compute, that is n torsion of Brauer group. And the quotient is going to be n torsion in Betti cohomology in degree 3. So it's just a question of combining the two sequences. And it exhibits the n torsion of the Brauer group as an extension of two parts. And how should you think of them? So the quotient, n torsion in Betti cohomology, you should think of it as the topological part of the Brauer group. Because I mean, it's purely topology. And the subgroup, it's not purely topological because there is the Picard group of S that is here. And the Picard group of S is entirely understood in terms of Hodge theory. Because by Lefschetz 1-1, the Picard group of S is, the image of the Picard group of S in H2 is exactly given by the Hodge classes. So this is Lefschetz 1-1 theorem. And for this reason, you should maybe think of the subgroup here as the Hodge theoretic part of the Brauer group. Okay. Okay. Now I will briefly explain. We need to construct surfaces over S, generically finite of degree n. So where will I find these surfaces? So I will take, I will set x to be equal to s times p1. And so it's a threefold. I will choose a over s, a line bundle that is sufficiently ample, very, very ample. So very ample line bundle on s. And my surface T, I will choose it to be a hypersurface in X living in the linear system that is A tensor N in the first factor and O of N in the second factor. So I choose it in this linear system. And so it lives in X, it projects to S. And the projection P is generically finite of degree n, just because I have chosen O of n here. Okay. Now I want, recall that I want to show that P upper star alpha is equal to zero. And I will do it in two steps. I want to show that some class in the Brouwer group of T vanishes. I will first show that the topological part vanishes. And when it is done, I will deal with the Hodge theoretic part. So the first step is to show that.
So you will do it for anything like that, or you will choose T?
Of course, I will choose T. Thank you. So just for notation, if I have a class alpha in the Brouwer group, I will denote alpha top its topological part, that is the projection to H3. And the first thing I need to do is to show that the pullback of alpha top vanishes. Okay, so how does it work? Alpha top is an n-torsion class here. I want to compute its pullback on T. What I will do is, to pull back on T, I can first pull back on X and then restrict to the surface by the inclusion. And it will be convenient to compute the class to push it back forward to X by the inclusion. Now, the first thing is that when you first restrict to T and push forward back to X, it's the same thing as taking the cup product by the class of T, by the projection formula. So this is really cup product by the class of T. But now if you look at my choice for T, the class of T is a multiple of n. So it's a cup product by n times something. And now alpha top was an n-torsion class here. So the n-torsion, and I take cup product by something that is a multiple of n, I get zero here. Okay, and now the second thing to notice is that this push forward here is an isomorphism by the Wick-Lefschetz theorem. And so I win, my class dies here, so it dies here, and this is what I wanted to show.
So here you don't need to choose.
Absolutely, but this was to be expected because this was something purely topological to prove. So it does not really depend on the surface in the linear system.
Oh. I don't know.
So maybe I don't erase theorem B.
It
does. I have H3 and H5 here. And T is a hypersurface, so it's in H2. Okay. Okay, so now what's next? So let me just rewrite the exact sequence computing the Brouwer group for T just to avoid confusion. I have H2 modulo the peak, the multiples of N and the peak R. I have the T torsion in the Brouwer group. And I have the quotient that is N torsion in the third Bethic homology group. Now, the pullback of alpha, we've just shown that its topological part vanishes. So it lifts here to a class that I will call beta in H2 of Tz. And what we need to do remains to ensure that my lift beta that belongs to the subgroup generated by multiples of n and by the Picard group. And I recall you that it's the same as the subgroup generated by multiples of n and Hodge classes. Absolutely, but I choose a representative in H2 because it will be easier to manipulate class in H2. So yeah, absolutely. I lift it in H2 and it's well defined up to multiples of n. And but then I prefer to view it in this way. I choose a representative in H2 and I want to show it belongs to the subgroup. And but there is no way that it holds. If the surface T carries very few Hodge classes. And how to overcome this problem? Well, just let T vary in moduli. T belongs to a linear system. I can let T vary in the whole linear system. So the family over the linear system, I will call it beautiful T over a base B. And some of the members of this family will have extra Hodge classes, and there is the hope that some of these members will have sufficiently many Hodge classes for beta to belong to this subgroup. And this is what will happen. Okay, so for this to happen, you need that the variation of Hodge structure associated to the H2 of the members of the family varies sufficiently. And so this is what happens. So now there is a very little difficulty. That is, not the whole Hodge structure varies, because in H2 of Tz, there is H2 of Sz that is constant because the surface S does not move. So the only part of the H2 that you can hope to vary is what is orthogonal to H2 of Sz. That is the so-called vanishing cohomology. So maybe let me write down precise things. So the Hodge structure, so in this family of surfaces, the Hodge structure, so H2 TBZ, so the vanishing part, so by definition, in H2 of TBZ is the orthogonal for the cup product of the cohomology of S, varies sufficiently so in the sense that there exists one point in the base and an open cone, let me call it omega, in the vanishing part of H2 of TBR. Such that every omega in omega becomes Hodge on some small deformation of TB. Is Hodge small deformation, say TB prime of TB. And so for this to happen, there is an infinitesimal criterion due to Green. And this criterion is hard to check in general, but in a generality sufficient for our purposes, it has been verified by Voisin. So in not really in this setting, but in a sufficient generality. So the affirmation that is here has been proven by Green and Voisin. Okay, and then what you do to conclude, so to conclude, maybe you modify beta by a multiple of n. Which you are allowed to do because beta is well defined up to multiples of n anyway. You can ensure that beta belongs to this cone. And then it means that beta is going to become Hodge, maybe on the surface you're looking at, but on some small deformation of it. And then you replace your surface by this small deformation and you win. So replacing the surface T you are looking at, say it was the one corresponding to this point little b on the base, given by Green Voisin. You replace it by the small deformation of this surface on which beta is going to become Hodge, thanks to Green Voisin, by TB prime given by Green Voisin. Ensures that beta, say, is a Hodge class. And now, up to modifying beta by a multiple of n, we've made it Hodge. I mean, this is exactly what we wanted to do.
I'm sorry. Don't you need to know that there is an orthogonal to H2 of S?
Yes, that's a very good point, and I've hidden something. So, so I need to show that up to maybe modifying beta by a multiple of n. And but this would not be true. What you really need is not that it belongs to the vanishing cohomology, but that up to modifying it by a multiple of n, then its component in H2 of SZ is Hodge. Mm-hmm. And this is really what you need, and this is really what is true. And to verify it is another application of Wieck-Lefschetz that I did not intend to present in detail.
So it is similar to this one?
It is an argument similar to this one, except you're not going to need isomorphism in these degrees by surjectivity in lower degree. You need the other. Yes. And so yes, indeed, it is a very, very important point. And as you formulated it, if you really wanted to show that up to multiple of n, it belongs to the vanishing cohomology, which is not quite true, but if you wanted to prove it, it's obviously a topological statement. So if true, it's normal that it's solved by topological arguments like Wieck-Lefschetz.
Excuse me, just to understand. Is it true that the topological part is always zero without any assumptions by Poincaré duality? Yes.
This group, you mean?
Yes.
No. By Poincaré duality, Poincaré duality is going to give you an isomorphism with H lower one of SZ. So if the surface.
Only for free parts, not for torsion. Only for free parts. And for torsion, there are different dimensions in Poincaré duality.
No. There is so let me think again. No, there is a version, there is Poincaré duality, and there is the good statement that is Poincaré isomorphism, taking into account torsion and non-torsion part. And if you formulate it in this, this is exactly the statement. It is all, yes. This is.
Definitely there are examples of surfaces with torsion in H3.
Yeah, okay.
For instance,
in
surface
faults. Yeah. When you formulate Poincaré duality with integral coefficients, you don't want to have cohomology and cohomology. Because if you take cohomology and homology, then this is an isomorphism, a canonical isomorphism. There is no choices. And So this is a good question. Of course, the statement that is this statement that I am proving is immediately reduced to. I mean, if you know it over C, you know it over any algebraically closed field of characteristic zero, just by the Lefschetz principle. Yes, absolutely. And it is an interesting. De Jong's theorem. Easily reduces to characteristic zero just by easy lifting arguments. There is no difficulty in this lifting argument. So in some sense, the case of complex numbers is the crucial one. Yes. Of course, you cannot run the arguments over any other closed field than the complex numbers, given the Hodge theoretic. Okay, so this was quite a. Okay, so now I want to explain how these arguments apply in the real setting. So what needs to be modified? So the first thing is that now I take my surface S over R, a smooth projective. And I'll find the Brauer group of its function field. The first remark is that you need only consider classes of period 2 by De Jong's theorem. I mean, since you know De Jong's theorem, just by a norm argument going to the complex numbers and. For instance, odd degree classes. The case of odd degree classes is an immediate consequence of De Jong's theorem, just by going to the complex numbers, because going to the complex numbers is a quadratic extension. So really, you immediately reduce to two torsion classes. Next, you are going to apply the same strategy. And everywhere, you are going to replace cohomology with equivariant cohomology. So for instance, just to give an example, if you wanted to describe the two torsion of the Brauer group of S, well, there will still be an exact sequence as this one. The quotient is going to be, so so it's not going to be this cohomology group. It's going to be equivariant cohomology with respect to the Galois group of C over R, that is Z mod 2Z, generated by complex conjugation and acting naturally on the complex points of the surface. And you will also want to let it act on the sheaf here. And you put Z of 1 to indicate that it will act by minus 1.
How do you see that, we need a non-trivial twist here?
Because you will run this proof, and here it will be mu n and not z mod n. And so here you will put z of 1, z mod n of 1, and this is what is needed for this comparison. And the subgroup, you it's the same. You're going to take equivariant cohomology of the complex points with value in z of 1, modulo the multiples of n, and modulo the algebraic classes. And this plays the absolutely the same role as this exact sequence over the real numbers. Okay, and now there are a few additional difficulties that I want to mention. When you compare the real proof and the proof I have explained right now. So the first one is that now my class alpha is ramified. It is not, it does not belong to the Brauer group of the whole surface, only in the Brauer group of the function field or of some small Zariski open subset. So you need to, in the proof, you need to be able to handle the ramification of alpha. So how will you do this? So after blowing up S, you can assume that alpha is ramified along a normal crossing divisor. So you can assume that alpha is ramified along a simple normal crossing divisor that I will call R in S. Then I will choose a divisor D in S in general position, smooth and transverse to R, so smooth divisor in general position. And with such that D plus R is a square of some line bundle. And to this data is associated a double cover of S that is ramified on D plus R. And so consider. So it is not smooth because D plus R is not smooth, but I can resolve singularities. So consider the resolution of singularities, the minimal resolution of singularities of the double cover. So it's a 2-to-1 cover, generically finite, ramified on the union of D and R. And now the point is that, I mean, in the proof, this is the surfaces that I will consider. I will consider this. I will construct my surface, the surfaces that will kill the class alpha. I will construct them in this way. I mean, they're 2-to-1 covers, so it's okay because I'm only interested in two torsion classes. So if I want to show they have index 2, I need to show that they're killed in some degree 2 cover. And the reason to have.
So it's not the trivial one bundle, but it doesn't matter.
Yes, it does not matter. Yes, yes, yes. I mean, yes. I mean, and the reason to choose my double covers to be always ramified over R is that ramification is ramification. So this just ensures that the pullback of alpha is going to be unramified on T. I mean, and this was absolutely necessary. If the pullback of alpha is ramified on T, then it's obviously non-zero. So it was absolutely necessary to kill the ramification of alpha, and the way it's done is by ensuring that my double covers ramify along R. So by this choice, the pullback of alpha is unramified on T. So by this, I really mean that it belongs to the Brauer group of T. And in the proof, the surfaces I will consider will be of this shape, and the moduli I need, it will be obtained by letting D vary in family. So we get a family of such surfaces by letting the other component of the ramification, that is D, vary in some linear system. Okay. You need to construct a degree 2 extension of the function field of S. This is really what you want to do, right? The root stack is going to be isomorphic to, if I understand correctly, isomorphic to S generically. So just looking at the root stack, you do not.
No. I mean, replace S by the root stack and then construct T for the root stack in the same way as you did before.
Yes, but if you do so, but now you replace it by the root stack. Now it's unramified on the root stack. Now you take a double cover, it is a stack on which it is unramified. But if you just do it on the coarse moduli space of the stack, it is going to be ramified. And so it cannot vanish in the function field. Yes. If you just let ramification go by a stacky trick, and you restrict your class to the function field, it may still be ramified in the classical sense. And if it is the case, then it is non-zero. Yes, absolutely yes. Yes. But there is no way, the double covers you look at, they really will need to be ramified. That's not what I mean. The shape of T above the ramification locus of alpha is extremely constrained. You cannot choose your double, because the double cover has to kill the ramification along R. So you really need to choose T very carefully above R. And this is one way to do it.
Yeah, this is what is handled by the root stack also.
Yes, but then I really want T to be a variety. Yes. Okay, maybe I should. Okay, so a second additional difficulty is induced by topology of real points. And this is this topology of real points. And this is something that appears when you want to apply weak Lefschetz. So first, let me quickly discuss. So if my surface has no real points, then there is a version of weak Lefschetz that applies. So I look at the push forward in the correct equivariant cohomology group. And I claim this is if S of is an isomorphism for I at least 3 and is surjective for I equals 2, but I need an ampleness hypothesis, and the hypothesis is that my Lyapunov L is ample. So if S has no real points, I have a version of Wiglaf-S that I will be able to use in this setting. And if there are real points, this fails. This fails in general. But it is OK under the additional assumption that the push forward at the level of H1 of the real points is surjective. So to have weak Lefschetz available, you need to choose the surface T. With the real points of the surface T, you need to choose them with a particular topology. For instance, in general, you cannot choose T to have no real points. Then weak Lefschetz will fail, and you will not be able to apply the argument. So to have weak Lefschetz available, you need to choose the real locus of T carefully. Okay, and the last thing I wanted to say, so the last difficulty is then you need to apply the Hodge theoretic argument, and so you need an analog of Green's infinitesimal criterion and of Voisin's theorem. So there is indeed an analog of Green's infinitesimal criterion. Okay, so there is. There is a real analog of Green's infinitesimal criterion. But Voisin's arguments, I do not know how to apply them over the real numbers. But I do not know how to apply Voisin. I mean, so instead, I verify Green's infinitesimal criterion in a very concrete way that uses very much the particular shape of my surfaces, the fact that they are double covers. Verify it concretely for double covers. I think I have listed the main differences of the actual proof of theorem B and the proof of the simplified statement I had given. And I think I might stop here.
Questions? Can you place real numbers on your real place field?
That's a very good question. The answer is no. Because of the Hodge theoretic arguments. Long's conjecture was about any real closed field. I don't think there is a... What has to do with only cohomological dimension works over any real closed field. And I have absolutely no strong indication that the statements should hold true over any real closed field. And there are other statements close. The statement concerning period index over real surfaces that are true over the real numbers by these Hodge theoretic arguments and that fail over general real closed fields. So it's really sharp, and I will not bet. And my statements, my proof obviously does not work in this general setting.
So was it yes or no? Did you not say that it does not work, or your proof doesn't work?
All the statements that I've written on the board today might be true over any real closed field. But other more general statements are true over the real numbers and fail over more general real closed fields. Other statements. But everything I've written on the board today might be true over any real closed field. Oh, it's a field that has the same algebraic property as the real numbers. So if you add the square root of -1, it becomes algebraically closed. So the Galois group is Z mod 2Z.
You don't need some ordering here.
So it implies that it is ordered in a unique way.
But it doesn't apply to its R itself.
Sorry?
But it doesn't apply to its R itself.
R is a real closed field.
Yeah, sure, but
Can you repeat? I'm sorry.
How does one construct other?
Oh, a beautiful one is because if you add the square root of I, you get a square root of -1, you get this. That is the algebraic closure of C double parenthesis T. So it's the typical, this is the typical complicated real closed field, for which my proof doesn't work at all.
No more questions? Just send the speaker.
Thank you.